honored to be here. Once I got to hear Paul Homer lecture on Soren Kierkegaard, I understood a few things that he said, and I hope you'll understand a few things that I say tonight. It's also a great privilege to talk to the Monsma family, who 17 years ago helped get this lecture underway. It's a great privilege to be introduced by someone who's just come back from Europe and is still awake. She has an excuse for falling asleep tonight, but I'm not so sure about the rest of you. So the topic, the Bible, race, and slavery as an enduring American problem. I'm speaking tonight about a persistent and often troubling theme in the American past. That theme is the large role played by Christian believers in Christian thinking in the United States' long, tangled, and fraught fixation on race. Why, you might ask, bring this subject up now? It's widely argued, widely agreed, that the election in November 2008 that saw Barack Obama selected as the United States' first African-American president marked a turning point. Since 2008, opponents of Obama have mostly criticized his policies, while his supporters have mostly defended those policies, except for a tiny fringe of the populace. The president's ethnicity has almost been a non-factor. Moreover, in this election cycle, economic concerns have dominated public attention almost to the exclusion of all else. Questions of racial or ethnic justice have been a small factor in debates over immigration reform, but they have not been otherwise prominent. Yet to historians who believe that many of the most important events in American history have involved race in conjunction with religion, public political attention seems myopic in the extreme. Guided by candidates eager to be elected and enabled by pundits eager to be heard, we Americans are mostly ignoring an alarming set of great and society-wide problems. Whether by comparison with other Western democracies or even by comparison with many countries in the so-called developing world, the American social order is riven with pathologies. These pathologies come from many directions and from many factors, but the nation's racial history is everywhere primed among these factors. Here's a short list. The United States has by far the highest rates of incarceration in the Western world. It witnesses more gun violence than any other so-called civilized country. Its entertainment industry glorifies violence, misogyny, sexual promiscuity, and infantile self-indulgence. It offers less medical and family support for the poor than any other Western nation. It maintains inequality of wealth on a par with the kleptocracies of the third world. Its rate of infant mortality is several times higher than most Western countries. And most grievously, the nation is witnessing a disastrous collapse of the two-parent family as the accepted norm for giving birth and raising children. The United States racial history is not solely responsible for these indices of pathology, but that history has contributed substantially to every one of them. My intention tonight is to describe five episodes in American history where each shows the powerful effects that race in conjunction with religion have exerted on American history. But I also want to add brief theological commentary for each of the episodes, since there are few subjects in the American past that so desperately require theological evaluation as the political history of race and religion. The history I'm sketching begins in the 1830s, and after opening up each of the episodes, I'll pause for brief theological commentary. And at the end, I'll try to make a summary statement. So first, religion, slavery, and the Civil War. In the decade of the 1830s, religious convictions began to play a prominent part in the United States' ongoing debate over slavery. In the earliest years of the United States, it seemed that slavery might simply fade away. But Once cotton growing plantations became profitable, slavery became an ever more important factor in all aspects of American life. Well, the northern states did gradually abolish slavery within their borders. Almost all of them maintained severe social restrictions on free black Americans. Religion entered the picture actively in the 1830s when a few northern abolitionists began using the Bible to attack slavery. In Western society as a whole, this attack was not unusual. Almost all European Protestants and many European Catholics had already concluded that the Christian faith simply could not tolerate slavery. In America, it was different. When abolitionists attacked slavery using the Bible, the defenders of slavery also turned to Scripture. They found many passages that offered the most straightforward acceptance of the system. Soon they were making an effective public defense. Abraham owned slaves, they argued. Moses regulated slavery. Jesus did not teach against slavery. And the Apostle Paul sent the runaway slave Onesimus back to his master Philemon. What can be clearer than the scriptural defense of slavery? From the perspective of the 21st century, this biblical defense of slavery seems pathetic. But in the United States at that time, it was powerful. Two factors made the biblical defense of slavery effective. In the first instance, the defense depended upon a democratic, commonsensical use of the Bible, and the churches of the new United States were flourishing precisely because they exploded a democratic and commonsensical approach to religious faith. In the first decades of the 19th century, American churches had become much stronger than anyone in Europe had thought possible because the churches made a successful adjustment to the separation of church and state. They grew with amazing speed because of the entrepreneurial leadership of ordinary men and women. Now on the issue of slavery, polemicists said, "Do not listen to the supposed experts, but read the Bible for yourself. If the biblical heroes of the faith did not attack slavery, then those who attack slavery today have to be opponents of the Bible." In the second place, it's easy today to see a striking fact about slavery that was taken for granted in Scripture. Whatever the Bible may say about slavery in general, there's no support in Scripture for the kind of black-only, racially specific slavery practiced in the American South. That critical nuance was mostly lost on white Americans in the 19th century, both North and South. So strongly fixed was the notion that slavery meant only people of African descent that it was very difficult to disentangle the question of slavery from the question of race. With this background, the American Civil War became a religious struggle as well as a military conflict. In this deadly conflict, the most prominent voices for the South defended the Confederacy as a godly republic. In their view, the North was not only an aggressor, but an infidel aggressor. Many in the North responded to the South's religious defense of the Confederacy by defending the Union as God's agent in the world. So the first part of my story is to suggest the greatest conflict in American history, the American Civil War, was a fundamentally religious event. The theological lesson I draw from this history concerns the use of the Bible. For Christian believers of whatever kind, the Bible must remain foundational in order for Christian faith to remain alive. Yet how Scripture is put to use required much more self-conscious discipline than offered by those who battled each other in the 1840s and the 1850s. Defenders of slavery wielded proof text-like weapons. Opponents of slavery responded with sentimental appeals to the spirit of the Bible. In neither case was Scripture challenging basic worldviews and ordering broad patterns of thought. To put it another way, the was coming into play much more actively to chastise opponents than it was to correct one's own dearly held opinions. Such ways of using the Bible contributed a great deal to the heat of the Civil War. They also contributed to a considerable weakening of biblical authority for the nation as a whole after the Civil War. Second drama, the effects of the Civil War on race and nationalism. Second part of this story is to explain what happened once the Civil War was over. As everyone knows, the North won the military struggle. But along with restitution of the Union came several other momentous consequences. Under the leadership of Abraham Lincoln, the United States abolished slavery. Under the leadership of Lincoln's Republican Party, the American Congress approved several constitutional amendments that provided full civil rights for freed slaves. But the abolition of slavery was not the same as the abolition of racism. In fact, probably racism became even stronger throughout the whole nation after the war. Local communities in the South struggled to assimilate vast numbers of liberated slaves, but they did not want to give them civil rights. Northern communities did just a little bit better by granting the civil rights demanded by the new constitutional amendments, but only reluctantly and partially. Moreover, because the North's triumph over the South was a military triumph, that triumph did not convince many white Southerners that their interpretations of the Bible had been mistaken. Rather, the conviction was strengthened that black people should be subordinated to white people in all aspects of society, especially politics. Victory in battle was not the same as victory in biblical interpretation. Victory in battle did, however, convince many in the North that the United States had a divine destiny important for the whole world. Abraham Lincoln thought through matters more deeply than most Americans, but he too affirmed that the victory of the Union and the abolition of slavery meant that the United States enjoyed special status as God's chosen means of promoting freedom in the world. After only a few years, as reconciliation between the white North and the white South took place, white Southerners came to share the belief that the Civil War had been a baptism of blood, giving the reunited United States a God-given significance for the whole world. For African Americans, the Civil War had a different meaning. In particular, free blacks and ex-slaves took advantage of the abolition of slavery to create black churches that became vibrant centers of religious and cultural life. Even as racist customs severely limited black participation in public life, even as what came to be known as Jim Crow laws stripped African Americans of civil privileges, despite these setbacks, black church life became a very important source of vitality for black communities. This reality did not seem too important in the last decades of the 19th century. Black African Americans were shut out of public life, and so it really made little difference for the nation as a whole if nobody paid any attention to them. And that's the way it was for 100 years. The lesson I take theologically from the religious effects of the Civil War concern visibility, what we might call today publicity. In the eyes of most observers, the most important developments after the war involved the reconciliation of North and South and the nation's new confidence in asserting a larger place in the world. Now reunited, now convinced of its destiny for greatness under God, the nation strode confidently toward an expanded role in the world. What happened in the formation or expansion of African American churches seemed only an insignificant sidelight. In a clear and sun-filled sky for the American future, the new or newly invigorated black churches resembled only a tiny cloud in that bright sky. But it was a cloud the size of a man's hand that would grow until one day, as in the biblical story of Elijah, it became a thunderstorm inundating the whole nation. For the moral future of the United States, what was most important in the years immediately after the Civil War was the least visible. So now, the third act, the effects of the Civil War on politics. Immediately after the Civil War, liberated slaves enjoyed about a decade of relatively full civil rights. They were, of course, strong supporters of the Republican Party, for the party of Lincoln had sponsored their emancipation. But then, strong reaction took place in the South, where weaker reaction also began to restrict black opportunities in the North. In the South, the occupying Union armies were removed in 1876. Soon thereafter, harshly repressive black codes all but eliminated black civil rights throughout the former Confederacy. In the North, widely pervasive segregation kept most African Americans as second-class citizens. Especially in the South, the new racist regimes were enforced by vigilante terrorism. From the 1870s into the 1920s, a horrific era of lynching prevailed in the South and in a few places in the North. Some years, violent mobs killed scores of blacks who were hung, burned alive, and even drawn and quartered outside the law for offending various conventions of the racial code. The key religious factor in this development was that almost all white churches in the South either supported or accepted the imposition of Jim Crow segregation and the successful assault on black civil rights. In the North, most of the white religious figures who had led the abolition movement lost interest in black civil rights once slavery was formally abolished. As much as religious conflict over slavery had driven the war between the states, to the same degree, religious indifference to black Americans sustained the retreat from civil rights after the war. Politically, the Democratic Party surged back into absolute control of the South by championing segregation and by attacking their opponents as black Republicans. The successful defense of the so-called Southern way of life against the Republican Yankees, who were still resented for the destruction of the Civil War, gave the Democrats a lock on political power in the South for almost a century. The Republican Party was much stronger in the North. Yet one of the main ways it accommodated itself to North-South reconciliation was to abandon the use of government as a major force in society. Into the 1870s, Republicans had been the party of big government. They had won the war with unprecedented military mobilization. In the first years after the war, they had kept an occupying army in the South that tried to enforce national civil rights legislation. Yet increasingly after the 1870s, Republicans turned away from the support of centralized government authority. Instead, they turned to principles of free trade and business laissez-faire. No longer did the Republican Party as a whole see the need to use centralized government power as the key force for running the country. By the end of the 19th century, connections between race, religion, and politics were defined by this new state of affairs. Southern Democrats and most Republicans defended a small national government. Southern Democrats did so in large part because keeping the central government out of Southern affairs meant that the Democratic Party could keep black people out of Southern politics. During this period, most Southern states prevented African Americans from voting. In the North, the small government philosophy was supported by most Republicans because this philosophy was friendly to the nation's rising industrial might, and because in truth it did lead to a very satisfactory life for many communities in New England, the Midwest, and the Far West. We're staying in downtown Minneapolis these days. A very impressive contribution to Midwestern life, and it is a post-Civil War development that big families who did General Mills and I guess the other mills took advantage of. The United States returned to principles of small central government, strongly reinforced the small-arm Republican and religious traditions of the nation's founding. Small R Republican ideals emphasize strict limits on government powers, even as they urge local organizations to manage local affairs locally. The strong religious traditions of the country fit very well with this Republican philosophy. Local churches operating locally seem the best way, not just to strengthen the faith, but also to preserve a strong social fabric. By 1900, these Republican attitudes were also coming to benefit a rising number of Roman Catholics who were joining Protestants and making the United States one of the most vibrantly religious regions in the world. The paradox involved in this situation can be stated simply. On the one hand, small government, Republican principles were stimulating economic growth. They allowed many local communities to flourish as centers of social well-being, and they offered a good environment for church growth and personal religious development. On the other hand, small government Republican principles allowed for violent racism to flourish. They permitted the South to stifle democracy, and they equated American patriotism with a minimal federal state. A genuine theological dilemma is posed by the circumstances I've just described. The United States political order, based on limited government and local initiatives, allowed religion to flourish and contributed greatly to moral as well as economic prosperity. And the United States political order, based on limited government and local initiatives, allowed racism to flourish and contributed greatly to immoral as well as economic tyranny. I've been thinking about this combination of realities for many years, and I'm at a loss for a quick or simple theological answer. So maybe the theological lesson to be drawn from the dilemmas of race and politics in place for so long after the Civil War is the need for theology to be serious, thoroughly grounded, and utterly realistic. Any other kind of theology will simply not be able to assist Christian believers in assessing the paradoxes of American history or offering a way ahead for the future. So we're on now to the fourth act in this five-act drama. The Civil Rights Movement as a religious movement. From the late 19th century into the 1950s, religion in public life worked to uphold the status quo. Evangelical and mainline Protestants in the South overwhelmingly supported the Democratic Party. In the North, evangelical and mainline Protestants leaned strongly to the Republican Party. Roman Catholics throughout the nation were solid for the Democrats because that party was friendlier to immigrant communities than the Republicans. At least until the Great Depression, black voters in the North strongly supported the Republicans as the party of Lincoln. Even though President Franklin D. Roosevelt was not an active promoter of civil rights, he did reach out with economic help for both whites and blacks, and so African American support began to shift in the 1930s to the Democrats. But it's worth noting that as late as 1960, Martin Luther King Sr. was an open and public advocate for the election of Richard Nixon as President of the United States. In general, for the period 1900 to 1950, religion seemed to fade as a political force because the strong religious political connections forged in the aftermath of the Civil War had become such an accepted part of the status quo. This status quo began to change in part because of World War II and the Cold War. A vague religion came back into public life when American leaders like Franklin Roosevelt joined Britain's Winston Churchill in defining the Second World War as the defense of Christian civilization against what they called pagan barbarism. And in the Cold War against the Soviet Union, American leaders spoke often of the Judeo-Christian values they depicted as threatened by the forces of godless communism. Yet if the great international conflicts of the 20th reintroduced religion into American politics, it was the civil rights movement that brought religion back into public life with full force. The key to this development was found in the black churches. In the 1950s, the light that had been hidden under a bushel began to shine brightly for all to see. Black religion, to be sure, was not the only force behind the civil rights movement. President Harry Truman played a part when he, by executive order, desegregated the military after World War II. Soviet propaganda played a role. The United States proclaimed itself as a free nation, the leader of the free world. Why are black people so restricted in their freedom in this supposed champion of freedom? Legal efforts for many organizations played a role leading up to the great landmark desegregation decision of the Supreme Court in 1954, Brown versus Board of Education, which made separate schooling for blacks and whites illegal. Yet even with all these other forces, the civil rights movement did not really take hold until black religious leaders mobilized a largely black church by using the language of prophetic Christianity to demand dramatic changes in the United States racist practices. Until this religious force entered the picture, housing remained segregated throughout the country, educational opportunities for African Americans remained severely limited, voting was still denied to blacks throughout the South, restaurants and hotels remained segregated in much of the nation, and the regime of Jim Crow put in place shortly after the Civil War remained firmly in place. The religion that inspired the Civil Rights Movement was a complex amalgamation. The justly praised stance of leaders like Martin Luther King Jr. is, of course, the best known. King's religion represented a direct descent from the prophetic, biblical, and evangelical religion that stretched back to the first Christian slaves. But it also reflected a full generation of influence from black intellectuals who in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s had promoted an intellectual and spiritual renaissance. In the harsh days of segregation, leaders like Benjamin Mays of Morehouse College in Atlanta and Howard Thurman of Howard Divinity School in Washington, D.C. wrote and spoke powerfully about the ability of self-sacrificing love to overcome barriers of inequality and hatred. These same leaders also drew on sources of inspiration that their white peers either shunned or despised. Several of them had studied the pacifism of Mahatma Gandhi and even traveled to India to learn the principles of nonviolent direct action. Others had begun to advocate socialism as a solution to America's racial problems. When Martin Luther King Jr. and other reformers began to preach these themes in public, the result was electric. King's biblical emphases reflected the long seasoning of black Christianity. They resonated powerfully with much in American popular religion. Yet his pacifism and his appeal to central government authority also added powerful innovations to that historically, traditionally American Christian message. These innovations for many Americans as profoundly disturbing as the religion was familiar. The civil rights movement was always more than what articulate leaders like Martin Luther King Jr. attempted. On the ground, in marches for voting registration, in beatings endured from angry Southern police, in daily struggles extending over a decade and more, the activity of ordinary African-American foot soldiers was just as important. The religion of these mostly unknown heroes of the civil rights movement was visceral, not cerebral, biblical, not philosophical, supernatural, not rational, prophetic, not theoretical. It was exemplified in the experience of Ann L. Ponder, who was once jailed in Winona, Mississippi, because of her efforts at registering fellow blacks to vote. As reported by a friend who was also in jail with her, Ann L. Ponder was beaten by guards when she refused to address them as sir, as this friend reported. But anyway, she kept screaming, and they kept beating on her, and finally she started praying for them. And she asked God to have mercy on her, because they didn't know what they was doing. The United States government first responded to appeals for reform through the courts. Brown versus Board of Education ruling in 1954 was followed gradually by other judicial decisions enforcing civil rights. Even more significant was a series of civil rights laws passed by the U.S. Congress. The first of these was enacted under President Eisenhower in 1957. It was not a particularly strong bill, but it did represent the first national effort to enforce civil rights in the states since the 1870s. Effective national civil rights legislation followed under the presidency of Lyndon Baines Johnson, who took up this cause as his way of honoring the memory of assassinated President John F. Kennedy. The result was landmark legislation in 1964, a general civil rights bill, 1965, Voting Rights Act, and by 1968, further legislation against discrimination in public accommodations and employment. The political effects of this legislation were immediate. In the first presidential election, after the passage of the Voting Rights Act, voter participation shot up in southern states with strong African-American populations, up, for example, 31% in Virginia, 52% in Alabama, 60% in Mississippi. Never in the nation's history did the United States government act so fast to remedy so many wrongs. Religious conflict accompanied the legislative conflict that led to the civil rights bills. Black Christians throughout the country were prime supporters. Some mainline Protestants also supported the civil rights legislation, but white Southern Protestants vigorously resisted almost all civil rights efforts. Evangelical Protestants not in the South mostly sat on the sidelines. In general, they recognized the evil of civil rights abuses, but they also worried about government intruding to repair wrongs and feared social disorder is a spin-off of agitation for reform. The leadership of the Roman Catholic Church was strong for civil rights, but many Catholic communities resisted reform when fair housing laws threatened the substantial parish neighborhoods they had built up around urban churches. If white Christian support was mixed for civil rights legislation, there was still one major difference when compared to the era of the Civil War. In that earlier period, the defense of slavery was based directly on the Bible, and recognized leaders of the church led that defense. Now in the 1960s, there were only paltry efforts to defend segregation of the Bible, and the fight against civil rights reform came from less well-educated and less highly placed individuals. White American Christians did not oppose civil rights reform with anything like the vigor that many white American Christians had defended slavery a century before. In sum, the combination of active black religion and passive white religion was enough to overcome the well-established legal structures that had long upheld the United States racist social order. The theological lesson I draw from this part of American history concerns activity in relation to receptivity. The civil rights movements gained at least some of their goals because their leaders articulated a strongly Christian message to an audience prepared to take this Christian message seriously. The many difficulties in moving rapidly on civil rights had come about because the Christian message from African American spokespersons did not conform to what many white Christians thought the public role of Christianity should be. Yet finally, the prophetic word found the wounded conscience. The claims from those who defined justice in Christian terms were accepted by a society that knew its practices defied Christian norms. I cannot think of any other modern social reform where the advocacy and the receptiveness to the advocacy have aligned as they aligned for the civil rights movement. If this analogy is correct, and if the civil rights movement can serve as a template for other efforts in changing social practices, it means that two things are needed for Christian social reform to succeed. First, there must be courage and clarity in proclaiming the reform as a mandate of Christianity itself. But second, there must be persuasive preparation of the body politic so that the appeal for reform falls on well-prepared soil. Both proclamation and preparation seem to be necessary. And so advocates of Christian social reform would do well to work hard at broad-based cultivation of moral sensibilities, even as they attempt courageously to proclaim the particular demands of specific reforms. Now, the last act concerns complicated reactions after the acceptance of civil rights reform. And this is a story that can be seen as relatively simple. Black leadership was key for civil rights reform. The absence of white resistance also eventually paved the way for those reforms within a matter of just a few years. First, should all of the churches agree that these were reforms that simply had to take place. But complications came about when the civil rights movement is set in a broader context, and two matters were particularly important. First, the successful implementation of civil rights reform required more government action by more government agencies than anything had taken place in the nation since the era of the Civil War. Civil rights legislation from Washington, decisions by the Supreme Court altered the way in which people had to live day by day in their local communities. Second, the expansion of central government authority on civil rights came along with expansion of central government authority on a host of other matters. It's particularly important to recognize the other areas where the powers of the federal government were expanding, even as the authority was being exerted for civil rights. In the 1950s, the launch of Sputnik by the Soviet Union galvanized the American government to sponsor the first ever national curricula for science in all of the nation's schools. I remember in junior high, 1 week, it was basketball. Not yet girls, that would come later. The next week, it was science and math. We got to catch up with the Russians. The national government provided textbooks by the leading scientists of the country. Some of these textbooks included offhand discussion of evolution, which had the impact of bringing back six-day creationism in opposition to evolution. About the same time, the Supreme Court acted to reinforce what it thought its best judgment was concerning the separation of church and state. 1962, the court ended the recitation of prayers in all of the nation's public schools. 1963, stopped devotional readings from scripture in the nation's public schools. Then in 1973 came the historic Roe v. Wade ruling, which guaranteed a woman's right to abortion. This decision, which vacated laws in all 50 states, has had powerful effects. Evangelical Protestants initially withheld their judgment on this decision, but soon came to view it as a grave offense against life itself. And this decision was an important lever in bringing some strands of Protestant conservatives and some strands of Catholic conservatives together in practical action. Soon, however, other fervent advocacy groups began to use the tactics of civil rights reform to argue for their own causes. Struggles for women's rights, struggles for homosexual rights, especially when carried out in the national courts and the federal legislature, swiftly became lightning rods for high voltage political conflict. Maggie and I get to leave Minnesota before some of that high voltage political conflict is played out here on November 6th. Most of this expansion of federal authority not on civil rights was anathema to white evangelical Protestants, and some of it gravely distressed practicing Roman Catholics as well. This agitation in turn contributed to the great political realignment of the political parties after the 1960s and to the nation's heated culture wars. The South, which had once been rock solid for the Democrats, now became primarily Republican. That shift has been driven by the massive movements of white evangelicals from the Democrats to the Republicans. Considered in religious and moral terms, one final index shows how strongly the civil rights movement affected the general political scene. In American society, the two demographic groups that are closest to each other in religious and moral terms are white evangelical Protestants and black church-going Protestants on beliefs about God, the Bible, Jesus Christ, and the way of salvation. They are almost identical. But in their politics, African-American Protestants are the nation's strongest supporters of the Democratic Party, while white evangelical Protestants have become the strongest supporters of the Republican Party. Whether the religious political configuration of the recent past will continue, time will tell. Things I've seen from the 2008 election and the forecast for the 2012 election would suggest that those divides continue. What kind of theological reflection is appropriate on this recent history? The long-term relationships of the American past have been durable, so firmly in place with the racist habits of American daily life that only a massive exercise of central government authority could shake them loose. Within a very short time, almost all religious voices in the country agreed that racial exclusion had been an evil allowed to survive for far too long, and that it was a positive achievement for the nation to be rid of its racist past in legal terms. But if white Protestants and Catholics could accept the massive extension of central government to promote civil rights, it was far otherwise with other extensions of government power. If these extensions were, in effect, the direct correlates of the expansion of federal authority required to achieve meaningful civil rights reform, by letting civil rights abuses go until they could be reformed only by central government authority, all American citizens were left to live with the expanded government authority that resulted. Why has the United States central government become so large in recent decades? One good answer is that American Christians, white Christian, tolerated an unjust, racist regime for far too long. And why did American believers tolerate an unjust, racist regime for so long? The answer to that question must surely be that self-interest and sinful pride triumphed over Christian altruism and the Christian mandate to love one's neighbor as oneself. Whatever the answer to such questions, it remains indisputable that the weight of the past bears down with real effect on the present. So now in conclusion, just a few last words. What this history, I think, tells us is that the place of the Bible and its interpretation have been critical in American history. It tells us that the contrast is important between what's visible and what's truly significant. It tells us that human social interactions are complex. It tells us that Christian social reform depends upon clarity of proclamation, but also thoroughness of preparation. And it tells us about the enduring influence of the past on the present. What ties these theological reflections together are the presuppositions that God exists and that God's self-revelation offers the best possible place for viewing political realities and for acting with integrity in the public sphere. Each of these theological reflections presupposes the sinful neediness of human beings as individuals and as social entities, and they presuppose that God's plan of redemption in Jesus Christ speaks comprehensively to individuals, but also to communities, nations as a whole, and the whole human condition. Because the Bible brings us Jesus Christ, the Bible must be relevant for political and social concern, but with the norms of Christ guiding the interpretation of Scripture. Because the standards of biblical faith show decisively what is truly significant and what is only passingly important, those who study the Scriptures should be able to differentiate for their own times and places between celebrated hype and true significance. Because the Christian message of Jesus Christ as true God and true human being offers believers a simple gospel with infinitely complex ramifications, followers of Christ should be able to see, define, and work with the great complexities of human existence. Because the gospel represents the perfect example of proclamation geared for an audience prepared for its reception. When the time had fully come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law. Therefore, those who follow the gospel can commit themselves wholeheartedly to the linked task of preparation and proclamation. And because biblical faith heralds God as sovereign over the past, the present, and the future, those who believe in God may take heart that the evil effects of one nation's sinful history need not write the ultimate word on the future of that nation. For Christian believers who every Sunday experience a little Easter dawn and a great deal of hope in our Redeemer, it may also be possible to look ahead with at least a measure of hope to the future of nations as well. The racial history of the United States is a cesspool of iniquity that has poisoned the nation's public life throughout our entire national history. But for those who believe that where sin abounds, grace abounds much more, for those who believe that the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ is also the Lord of history from beginning to end, such one should be able to see signs of redeeming hope in our national past and look forward with at least a measure of hope for what is yet to come.